So this is a piece of painted pottery.
Huge discoveries are often made from the smallest and most seemingly insignificant of items.
It comes from a small jar, ceramic jar that would be used for salves or ointment, a little medicine jar. And it's very easily dated to the mid to late 16th century.
Analysis of the chemical makeup of the paint and the pottery, the design of the item, a review of the historical and archaeological record, it all plays a part in identifying a new discovery.
A piece of Spanish pottery, and this is an example from what we call an olive jar. And you can see it's glazed on the interior. It has a ripple sort of surface, and that comes from having been thrown on a potter's wheel.
They are tiny fragments, snippets, of life long ago. They provide little information separately.
This is a classic small nail, and it's you can see it's hand wrought. And you look at this, is a lead ball for use in the arquebus. We know they had arquebuses with them, which is the oldest form of firearm.
But collectively, archaeologist Dr. David Moore calls the items the long-sought evidence of the first inland fort built by Europeans in the New World.
Principally includes artifacts that would be carried and used by the Spanish soldiers themselves. Mm-hmm. It's not a trade assemblage. It's an occupation assemblage.
The items were discovered during the excavation of a Native American village called Joara, which was built by the mound-building Mississippian culture. It was settled around 1000 AD. More than 1,000 people called the village home. The mound in the center of the village was a ceremonial area and a burial ground. The area is a farm now, but Moore and his archaeology students from Warren Wilson College have uncovered pipes, pottery, tools, arrowheads, and other examples of everyday life in the Juara village. The items fill the archaeology lab at the college, and the finds help paint a picture of life in the Americas before Europeans arrived.
Even if you're finding the same things, you're learning more about the structure of the village, where the houses were, where the Spanish men were, where they did their cooking, where they made pottery, the different activities that take place on the site.
Researchers had found evidence of Spanish soldiers in the village, but Spanish documents had also told of a fort built by gold-seeking Spanish conquistadors in the 16th century. However, there was no proof of the fort until now.
There are hundreds and hundreds of examples of Spanish artifacts that were traded to Indians throughout the Southeast. The glass beads and knives and chisels. But what this represents here are items that were almost never, in case of nails and lead shot, never traded to the Indians.
Native Americans have lived in this area because there's good soil for farming, there was plenty of game, and there's water. There's a creek just on the other side of these trees. And archaeologists have studied this site for almost three decades, trying to learn more about the people who lived here, but also trying to find evidence of the Spanish, because it was known Spanish soldiers followed Native American trade routes, and they built their forts in the middle of villages. It was 1566. Spanish Captain Juan Pardo and his men set out on an inland journey from their settlement, Santa Elena, on the coast of South Carolina. They built six garrisons during their trek, part of the Spanish effort to colonize the New World and search for gold. In what would become the North Carolina foothills, some 300 miles inland, Pardo built Fort San Juan in 1567. It was the largest of the forts, and it preceded England's lost colony at Roanoke Island by 20 years and Jamestown by 40 years. The search is painstakingly slow. Thin layers of soil are removed and sifted. Any items of possible interest, no matter how small, are cataloged for where and when they were found and then saved for further study.
A flake is made when people are flint napping. They are working wood to make it into a sharp point. And little flakes come off that look like that. They're uber sharp.
And the soil itself tells a story. That's another reason the excavation moves so slowly. Soil, takes time to read and understand.
You need to pay close attention to like soil changes in color to where you're getting down to like the subsoil.
Once researchers dig through what is called the plow zone, the depth to which a plow disturbs the soil, color changes in the soil explain what happened on the surface.
A lot of what's important right now is just analyzing what layers of soil go together. So a lot of the structure of the mound itself and the fort came from just looking at the colors of the soil.
These are not natural soils here. The different colors come from human activity. That's what we're doing. We're looking at different soils all the time. And what we have to do is determine which of those soils is caused by what activity.
So the wall of the fort, they build a moat around the fort.
This is the moat right here.
Dark stains in the soil adjacent to the 5-foot deep moat indicate the palisade, a quickly constructed wall made from cut trees that surrounded the fort. The size of the fort is still a mystery.
You're always finding something to try to figure out. You're seeing interesting artifacts, trying to understand what the soils represent.
The Spanish built their fort in the middle of the Native American village. It was a way of asserting their authority over the village. 18 months after the fort was built, 25 soldiers stationed there were dead.
Indians formed their relationships and cemented those relationships with bonds of reciprocation. And the Spanish weren't giving anything back. They weren't here to trade with the Indians. They were here to take their land. And once the chief here decided that this was no longer worth his while, and he wanted to send a message, it was probably the same situation at all the villages where the forts were. So they killed the men, and they sent back one man back to Santa Elena, and had him say, you know, this is it.
And roughly 20 years later, the village of Joara, with its 1,000 Native American residents, was abandoned. Nobody knows why.
As European colonizers came and seized land and tried to negotiate a new cultural landscape here, the Indians had to do the same. They had to cope with it, react to it. They weren't defenseless people. They weren't unsophisticated people. They had to figure out what was going on and cope with it as best they could, too. So this was the classic colonial experience.